To our next speaker, who is Donato Bini from the University of Rome, discussing hyperbolic-like encounters in a two-body system, analytical treatment, recent developments, and open problems. So, Donato, this is yours.
Thank you. Can you see my screen?
Very well.
Okay. Okay, I think I will use this time, 45 minutes, and then leave some minute for questions. So the work I will briefly review here belongs to a series of papers we have written in collaboration with Thibaut Damour and Andrea Geralico. And the main topic is to discuss the tutti frutti method, the one which has allowed to reach modulo several unknown parameters, that is six parameters in total, the 6PN level of accuracy in the discussion, in the treatment of the two-body system. So if you want to discuss the relativistic two-body problem, you have to solve Einstein's equation. And these are sourced by the energy momentum tensor associated with the two bodies, which is of course Dirac delta singular along the word lines of the two bodies. This makes the problem very difficult to solve unless one uses some approximation method or eventually numerical relativity. So in principle, one has to introduce a perturbation to the metric, solve the perturbation equations, then reconstruct the metric, then find the geodesics associated with the full metric, and then convert into the Hamiltonian, and then extract gauge invariant information from this. And there are several approximation methods, which I list here as possible tools with a check to the methods actually I have been using, we have been using. There is a post-Newtonian approach, which means weak field slow motion. And up to now is fully known at 4PN. Even if we have results at 5 and 6 partially partial results. Then there is the post-Minkowskian, in which the field is still weak, but the motion can be relativistic. And then there are several other used tools, like gravitational self-force, for example, which is a sort of reread the perturbation theory around black holes, and then multipolar post-Minkowskian expansion, matched asymptotic expansion between near and far zone. We have already heard about this. Numerical relativity, scattering amplitudes, Feynman diagram, and effective one-body too. Effective one-body is a possible convenient way to rewrite the Hamiltonian of the system in the sense which will be illustrated in a moment. Indeed, in recent years, we have seen a useful flow of information from different contexts converted immediately in AOB because it is actually a very flexible formalism. So, we have witnessed useful synergies between all these methods. And if there is a new result coming out from each of them, then it's important and quite immediate to convert it in EOB, what we have done in these years. Post-Minkowskian, just a few words. We are all astonished by the recent results. Starting from 2019 by Zvi Bern and collaborators on the 3PM first conservative Hamiltonian, and then for partial result, so this potential graviton scattering Hamiltonian at the level of 4 pm. This is astonishing if one thinks that the previous results, so the 2 pm results, dates back to 40 years ago, due to Bell, Damour, Deruel, Ibanez, and Chus Martin, and also to Westphal in the early 80s. Besides post-Minkowskian, I must say that in the last years, but in the last 40 years, post-Newtonian approach has played a very important role. And for instance, by using Arnowitz, Deser, Misner coordinates and in the center of mass, has allowed to write down the Hamiltonian, let's say up to 4 pm, since this is complete, as the sum of the several contributions, Newtonian, one post-Newtonian, second post-Newtonian, third post-Newtonian, fourth, and et cetera. And you see here the various pieces with some boxed term, which I will comment in a while, written in the center of mass system and using standard notation for the reduced mass and the symmetric mass ratio and the total mass. Okay, if we look at these expressions, we see first some polynomiality in the inverse radial variable, and we see also polynomiality in the symmetric mass ratio. But we see that the number of terms increases as soon as the PN level of approximation increases as well. And at 3 PM, the Hamiltonian can be still written and uses half a page. And you see here now the cubic level in the symmetric masses ratio plus the usual polynomiality in the radial variable. Things change immediately because at 4 pm one must distinguish between a local Hamiltonian and a non-local part. And we are less familiar with the non-local Hamiltonian. So this is the result of Damour, Yaronosky, and Schaeffer in 2014. And now only the local part of the Hamiltonian uses a page. And then and to this one has also to add the non-local part, which is symbolically is written here. But let's say, first observation is that when there is a non-local part into the Hamiltonian, the best thing you can do is to take averages. But this Hamiltonian has been checked within three different family of co-workers, that is ADM and EOB people. The Damour, Yaronosky, Schaeffer were the first to introduce it. Then harmonic coordinate, Bernard, Blanchet, Boet, Faye, Marsat, then effective field theory, Foffa, Porto, Rothstein, Sturani, etc. So from this, we learned the basic structure. And let's see what EOB does with this Hamiltonian. EOB was introduced long ago now, in 1999 by Alessandra Buonanno and Thibaut Damour. One can say it's a way to resum terms in a very convenient and efficient manner, in the sense that the real Hamiltonian of the system is encoded into an effective Hamiltonian, first square root, which, as you see here, second square root, is written in terms of several potential. And it appears in the literature in a given gauge. This is called the Damour, Yaronosky, and Schaeffer gauge. And let's say, looking at this expression, one easily recognizes that it is adapted to circular orbits or to quasi-circular orbits in the sense that if PR is equal to zero, as it is the case along circular orbits, this effective Hamiltonian reduces a lot, okay? Simplifies a lot. And then it can be seen as an expansion, a series expansions in powers of the radial momentum. So if, for instance, one needs to study eccentric orbits, one can select the level of eccentricity, or if one wants to truncate at a certain post-Newtonian level, only a number of this potential enter the discussion. Okay, but the main point is that this is adapted somehow to elliptic-like motion. And everywhere the angular momentum, apart from this term, is replaced in terms of the radial momentum. If you look at this EOB Hamiltonian and truncate it at a given PN order, it is canonically equivalent to any other Hamiltonian written in any other different coordinate system. So at least you can say that EOB is another convenient coordinate system. But there is more, because look, you remember the PN expanded, the full PN expanded Hamiltonian was including actually a lot of terms, and the number of these terms we have seen increases as soon as the PN order increases as well. Okay, the advantage, one of the advantages of using EOB is that, for instance, at 2PN, the main radial potential and the other potential D bar, the first one appearing at PR square level, only include two terms. All the rest, Schwarzschild 1PN, is already included in these previous terms. At 3PN, the only corrections are these three terms. So there is a clear advantage in the sense that the number of coefficients appearing in the EOB potential is strongly reduced with respect to the number of terms appearing in the equivalent Hamiltonian written in any other coordinate system. From the computational point of view, this is undoubtedly an advantage. Then we can look at the structure, and this is like before. U here is the inverse radial variable, and you see up to 3PN polynomiality in U. You see also polynomiality in the symmetric mass ratio nu. And there is the starting of some transcendental structure in the coefficients because there appears this pi square. anyway, up to 3PN, it seems a very big advantage. At 4PN, this is still possible to write down the potentials, which should be splitted as the Hamiltonian in the local and non-local parts, completely in half a page. So the only potentials entering at 4PN are these three potentials listed here, the radial, the first coefficient in the quadratic radial momentum, and then radial momentum to the 4 and to the 6. But previously, I was showing in a page only the new terms. Now I'm showing in half a page the full term, the full potential up to the 4PN level. But I want not to say anything else. I mean, EOB has 20 years, more than 20 years, so these things are known. Let's make a comment on the structure again. Now, you see the presence of the log means that the polynomiality in the inverse radial variable at 4PN, because this term is a 4PN term, modifies by the presence of the log. Whereas the polynomiality in the symmetric mass ratio survives. Okay, in all these terms. Also, the transcendental structure is enriched because besides the pi square terms, now you have Euler gamma and there are many log appearing. Okay, looking at this expression, we may have hint for what can be the next term in the in each of this potential, and we can attempt using them in a parameterized form. But indeed, there are so many parameters to introduce, and one has to do something better if possible. What happens if you go beyond the 4PN level? One has to determine new terms in the potentials which already enter at the 4PN level, besides the new potentials which are entering for the first time at 5PN, 6PN, etc. Not only their local parts, but also their non-local parts. Still, we may think of some structure in the results, that's to say, polynomiality in the symmetric mass ratio and functions involving the inverse radial variable with all powers and logs. Here comes tutti-frutti method. Tutti-frutti method is this, strange machine which keeps information from some other context, averaging formalism, self-force, etc., incorporates, elaborates, and gives the 6PN local and non-local part of the two-body Hamiltonian. This is especially done within the UB framework, because as I said many times, it's very convenient to capture information from any other context and translate into it. This is the program. Then I will give some additional detail for each of these steps. There are a few steps, but the starting point is to look at the non-local effects, the non-local part of the Hamiltonian at 6PN. We know that the non-local terms arise for the first time at 4PN. And so if I consider the 2PN modifications to this, which is called the flux split, we will see it in a moment, I will reach the 6PN. Okay, the first thing is that averaging this Hamiltonian can be done. Okay, but this is a first use of a gauge invariant information. I can take this non-local part of the Hamiltonian, which is naturally written in harmonic coordinates, take the average, compute the flux split integral, do the same in EOB coordinates, compare the two, and fix completely the non-local part of the EOB potentials up to the 6PN level. So this is the first accomplishment, and this is also the first message, which I will repeat during my talk. Non-local effects up to 6PN are easy to compute, in spite of this absolute value here in the denominator. There are ways to get rid of this average. And then you have a good result. I mean, all the non-local EOB potentials are fixed. So what remains is to compute, to determine the local part of the EOB potentials. So the next step is then an external computation, which could have been done even before, but this was not existing in the literature, so we had to do ourselves. To complete this task, one needs two things: self-force and the first law of binary black hole mechanics, obtained just 1 year before that analytic computation in cell force could start by Alt, Alexander Letiek, Luc Blanchet, and Bernard Whiting. Put together these two ingredients, so evaluate from perturbation theory, from gravitational cell force, the redshift along elliptic-like motion, expanded in eccentricity, up to the level of eccentricity which is needed to reach the 6 PN level of accuracy in our Hamiltonian later, and compare. So, and compare with the use of the first law with what can come from the Hamiltonian when one uses again undetermined parameters in parametrized form. But cell force has a problem. It exists only for the moment, fully analytic. There are attempts to go beyond, of course, at the first cell force level. So all the analytic results which cell force has provided up to now are results which are linear in nu. I will say something about this and the attempts going beyond this first order in nu level, which are currently done in these years later. Okay, but then this is the use of a second gauge invariant information, because the redshift is a gauge invariant information, and an external computation, because most of the work is done here to evaluate the redshift. Converting this information allows to determine the nu to the one power, all completely fixed, quindi, part of the EOB potentials. But this is still not enough, because as you have seen at 2 PN, there exists nu square, 3 PN, nu cube, etc. And then at 6 PN, we have high powers, nu to the six also to take into account. So the number of unknown coefficients will be high. And then the method uses a third gauge invariant information. That is to say, computes the scattering angle in EOB with, again, undetermined coefficients, uses a golden rule, concerning the mass structure, the new structure of the scattering angle, and this will allow to fix most of, we will see, 99%, most of the missing coefficients from cell force. Indeed, at 5 PN, there are two only missing coefficients of about 100, and at 6 PN, there are four additional missing coefficients of about 200. That summarizes. This is the program. I cannot enter many details. I will try to give you something, since here there are different communities. But again, let me list the gauge invariant involved. Gauge invariant quantities involved in the tutti frutti approach is this averaged Hamiltonian, which has given the first non-local part of the EOB potential, the computation of the redshift with cell force, and then using the first law of binary black hole dynamics, and then the scattering angle, which we have been hearing a lot in these days. So a few words concerning cell force. I should say this is a standard black hole perturbation theory done at Reggio Wheeler-Zerilli, conveniently if the background is the Schwarzschild black hole, or a Lateukolsky, even if the Kolsky can be used also in the first case, if the background is the Kerr spacetime. The program is standard. One writes down a perturbation to the Schwarzschild metric, 10 coefficients depending on four coordinates, expand in spherical harmonics, so remove the angular dependence of all these coefficients. Fourier transform in time, so remove the time dependent of all these 10 coefficients, and is left with 10 radial ordinary differential equations, which is an advantage because now these are ordinary differential equations. They are also split according to the parity of the harmonics they are obtained from. And the beauty of the Reggio-Wheeler's really approach is that even if you are in the odd sector or in the even sector, the master equation is the same in the sense that the homogeneous part of a single equation representing the 10 unknown is the same. Then if you are in the even sector, there are even source terms. If you are in the odd sector, there are odd source terms. But since source terms in ordinary equations can be taken into account by using the Green function method, one only needs a set of two independent solutions of the homogeneous Reggio-Wheeler-Zerilli equations. This set of solution can be done in different ways. There are post-Newtonian-like solutions. Post-Newtonian reconstruct, let's say, the black hole horizon little by little, as soon as the post-Newtonian level increases. So post-Newtonian starts considering, let's say, singular points at the origin, R equals zero, and the infinity. But we know, and we discover if we don't know, that after a while, the horizon comes into the game, and then we need a different set of solution which are regular at the horizon and at infinity. And this exists, have been obtained in the 90s by Manu Suzuki and Takasushi, and both of them are necessary to complete the task. Imagine that now you have solved the problem in the sense that you have been obtaining the final solution of your inhomogeneous equation. This is not the end of the story because now you have to fully reconstruct the perturbed metric. So you have to resum in the magnetic number M, which ranges from minus L to plus L, and then resum in L, which ranges from zero to infinity. Resummation in M, it's easy. Resummation in L, it's not so easy in the sense that the series as it is divergent and necessitates to be regularized. One has to remove the singular field. This is well known and doable. There is also another problem which concerns the gauge dependent low multiples, the multiples corresponding to L equals zero, which is physically equivalent to an addition of mass to the black hole, and L equal one, which corresponds to the addition of angular momentum. But in the most of the cases, these problems can be both of them solved. There is no time to enter the details, but then one you have resummed the perturbation, you can compute some gauge invariant quantity. And then, like for instance, the redshift as it is the case, the periastron advance, some gyroscopic precession, etc. And then you can convert this information in the Hamiltonian formalism. So this task is very demanding from the computational times needed to complete the needed results. Just to show you, to get the 6PN results, we had to obtain the redshift expanded in eccentricity, including the 8th power of eccentricity. This means, roughly speaking, that the source terms in the Reggio-Wheeler-Zerilli equation are Dirac delta singular, this is we know, but involve derivatives of the Dirac delta up to the 8th derivative. So long expression, very long expression, which can be done only by using computer algebra manipulator systems like MAPLE, the one we use, or Mathematica. And this is an example on how in this complementary this computation appears these coefficients. So you see. Remember, let's say the left-hand side here comes from a self-force computation, and luckily we have at disposal the right-hand side, that is to say the binary black hole dynamics, two-body dynamics, first law to convert these results into the Hamiltonian formalism. So, solving for the redshift, then convert into the UB potential, which bear the same structure as before, and then it's done, because if you have used the UB potential with the known coefficients, these are fully determined. So I would like to add here these slides, because this is an example of output of a self-force computation, in this case of the redshift, but any other computation is of the same type. And here is truncated at the level U to the 9. U is always the inverse radial variable. But in one case, Chris Kavanagh and collaborators reached the incredible results of U to the 22. I think that here there is a difference between MAPLE and Mathematica. Because it's if you are not very smart with the programming in MAPLE, there are continuous crashes when you are generating large and large expression. Instead, maybe Mathematica it's more powerful. But anyway, we have seen this result, this incredible results, only for one computation. Okay, let's summarize. As I started saying, the computation of the non-local, let's say tail-related parts of the UB potential is easy, and beyond, in principle, one can go even beyond, but the non-locality becomes more involved. These split integrals should be computed evaluating the square of the quadrupole, electric quadrupole moment plus octupole, et cetera, along the orbits. The orbits can be represented in this quasi-Keplerian form up to 2pn, which is what is necessary to reach the 6pn. And there is a difficulty to get closed form expression because of this square root here, which enters all the terms. But expanding in small eccentricity, all the integrals can be done. And this is the building block of the non-local Hamiltonian. Only to summarize again, equating the two computations, the harmonic coordinate-based and the EOB coordinate-based one has fully determined the non-local, but the local has to be still determined. This is to list the final form of the non-local part of the coefficients entering all the EOB potentials up to the 6pn level. Now, as I said, one has to compute another gauge invariant quantity, which is the redshift. And the redshift is a special quantity, which in self-force, it comes out incorporating both local and local and non-local effects. Okay, so now we have a quantity which includes both local and non-local. We have already computed non-local, subtracted two, and obtained local. I think that now I have been more clear with respect to what I was saying roughly in the first slides, the program, let's say. And indeed, we computed the redshift using 1SF and using the full UB Hamiltonian, connecting the two results via the Letiec, Blanchet, and Whiting formula for the redshift. Compare the two, let's say subtract non-local from the full local plus non-local objects, identify the local part of the EOB potentials, but only linear in nu. If we stop here, we still have a number of unknown. You see, all these terms have a new structure, may have a new square, new cube, blah, blah. And so there is a number of missing terms if we stop here. So maybe all this work is not so efficient if we still have all this unknown. But there is the use of the tutti frutti method, another gauge invariant variable, which is the scattering angle computed along hyperbolic orbits. And now the golden rule, which help us, is the one found by Damour in 2020, which states for the various coefficient in the large A expansion of the scattering angle, rescaled by the total energy, a precise polynomiality in the symmetric mass ratio up to a certain degree. If we impose this rule, we are able to complete our task. Indeed, proceeding as before, we compute the scattering angle by using parameters for what we don't know. And then using this rule, we determine the missing coefficients, as I will show you in a moment. In this case, we found it convenient to work not in the JS gauge, but in the so-called energy gauge. The standard DJS gauge is convenient when you work with the elliptic-like orbits because it comes out as an expansion in the radial momentum. But now we are along hyperbolic orbits, so we can have large radial momentum contributions, and this is not the most convenient gauge. So changing the gauge, which is easy to do, and then one writes the corresponding Hamiltonian, computes from the energy conservation the radial momentum, differentiate with respect to the angular momentum, integrates and gets the scattering angle at 5 and 6 p.m. So, results. At 5 p.m., first, we have determined the Hamiltonian modulo two unknown. And at 6 p.m., we have found four additional unknown. So, thinking of all possible terms entering the real Hamiltonian at 6 p.m., we have determined 147 terms of 151 total number of terms. These numbers at 5 p.m. Were simply replaced by 95 of 97. Okay. So the missing terms are quadratic in nu, in the symmetric mass ratio. So one SF cannot help. We need second order self-force. And second order self-force, if I succeeded in convincing you that first order self-force is a big, it's a non-trivial task, second order self-force, it's much worse. And there are recent results for second order self-force, mainly from the numerical sides, but we are confident that something will be given in the next future. So to complete the tutti frutti results, if second order self-force results were available, it's done. Now, since these do not exist, we are waiting from results coming from our friends working with the amplitudes and et cetera. So what remains? You see here, there remains only these coefficients, d bar 6, d bar 5, e 6, and a 7. So the A terms come from the radial potential. So in principle, they can be obtained by studying circular orbits, which is a big simplification. And the D bar are the first eccentricity correction, but at the level of nu square. even more in your cube. And so this is the point where Tutti Frutti method has arrived. One can think, in principle, to go beyond the 6PN level. So in this diagram, lines represents the post-Newtonian levels. These columns, since U is GM over C square R, represents the post-Minkowskian levels. And there are solid dots, which correspond to the coefficients in the powers of nu, which are fully known, and empty circles, which instead corresponds to those which we don't know. So you see, if you go at 6PN, there are these four white dots, which are unknown, as I told you. At 5PN, there is these two, which indeed it's what I said. But if you go at 7PN, then there is one, two, other two, four, and six. And so perhaps this is not needed in the sense that it's not, we are not ready to use a number of 10 unknown parameters for the 7PN. But in principle, this can be done. It's not convenient now. Perhaps once we have fixed a few of the parameters entering the preceding orders, we can go beyond, because the strategy is always the same. Okay.
Donato,
remains
15 minutes, including discussion.
Thank you. Yes. So what we can do? What are the next challenges, in my opinion? What can be done? It's easy to improve the present knowledge of the non-local part of the scattering angle. We obtained the order G7 recently, and in principle, we can go beyond. And the next important possible issue is to compute the radiation reaction contribution to chi, which we have obtained long ago now, about 10 years ago at 2PN, and under certain hypotheses. Before getting the conclusion of the talk, I will say something about this point and this point. The N to the N leading order computations for the non-local part of the scattering angle of the local part of the Hamiltonian can be done in the time domain, but then one has to compute integrals of this kind, which are singular along the bisectric in line in the TT prime domain. And one should always expand in a large eccentricity to hope to get some results. Even doing this, so expanding in large eccentricity, one generates very large expressions. And computer algebra system cannot give the results immediately. So first, one can do numerical computation with a high number of digits. This was the result of a fruitful collaboration with the high energy people like Stefano Laporta and Pierpaolo Mastrolia. This is just an example of a quantity which has been computed with 250 digits, and then by using some resummation algorithm like the PSLQ1 converted into a result, into analytical result. And you see here, these are intermediate steps, the appearance of another interesting transcendental structure, the Catalan constant, the Riemann zeta function of 3, etc. Let me say that the Catalan constant cancels in the scattering angle, and both the Catalan constant and zeta 3 disappear when computing the periastron advance, leading only to rational coefficients only. Okay, But besides doing this PSLQ extraction of results, then we were able to check analytically the results, and the key integral is this one I show you. There are powers of hyperbolic arctangent and three logarithms. In general, there are polylogs. And this could be computed expressing the result in terms of harmonic polylogs of a certain way, just to show you this. And if you go beyond, imagine that the integrand is the repetition 300 times the repetition of this block, and one can perhaps only do things numerically. We did this, and then we used the PSLQ algorithm to get the final numbers. In most of the cases, one can check analytically the results, but it's important when you perform the PSLQ algorithm to have an idea of the structure of the number you are trying to reconstruct. If you don't know anything about the structure, then this is very difficult, if not impossible. Also in this case, to get analytical results, the collaboration with Stefano Laporta and Pierpaolo Mastrolia was fundamental. So this is the time domain. What about the frequency domain computation? Because sometimes computations in the frequency domain are much easier and perhaps illuminating in comparison with the brute force computation in the time domain. Let me say that one has to face with expression like this involving Bessel K functions, but the integration variable in this case appears either in the argument of the Bessel function, but also in the order. And this is a big complication. So you are forced to expand in a large eccentricity because this P is something like U divided by eccentricity. So when you expand in large eccentricity, you generate Bessel K zero. But then you need the derivatives with respect to the order, not of the variable, to the order of the Bessel K function. And this is not known in general. I mean, only the first few terms of this expansion are known. And then besides this, you face up with the integrals of this time involving arctan of tan h and several functions involving the product of the Bessel function and some cosine and sine. And then the best tools we could find is to use the Mellin transform in this case. Let me say that the level of present knowledge of the derivative of the Bessel function with respect to the order belongs to the mathematician Brichkov mainly. Dates the most recent results to my knowledge is 2016. And if you look at the second derivative, the right-hand side, which defines these derivatives, it's a mess. And involves also hypergeometric functions and the Meyer-J function. So difficulties are behind the door, but anyway, up to the level we were interested in by using tricks, Mellin transform, etc., we could accomplish our task. One slide for this radiation reaction. In 2012, by studying first order radiation reaction effect and under several other assumptions, we were able to prove that the contribution to the radiation reaction of the scattering, to the scattering angle of the radiation reaction can be written in terms of something which comes out of the conservative scattering angle plus the radiation, the radiated energy, the radiation reaction energy of the system along hyperbolic orbits and the angular momentum. The formula is quite simple. It is obtained by passing from the conservative case to the case in the presence of a radiation reaction by using a variation of the constants method. So the constants which vary in this case are the energy and the angular momentum and the angular displacement movement of the apsidal line, but the latter is not contributing within the approximation we were studying at the time this problem. So this is still a work in progress. We are trying to generalize these results, going at a certain fixed PN level of accuracy, but at high order in PM sense. I must say that the tutti frutti method as we heard from previous talk, has received the partial confirmation and 90%, let's say, and of the two missing coefficients at 5 PN, the pi square part is fixed. And we have already checked this. So what remains is to determine the rational coefficients only. Summarizing, can the tutti frutti method be applied beyond the 6 PN? Yes, as I told you, but then you will have, if you do this now, an additional number of undetermined parameters, and perhaps is useless for the moment, maybe tomorrow, I don't know. We certainly can go beyond at G8, 9, whatever you want, level in the computation of the non-local part of the scattering angle, as I have shown you. Maybe combining works done in the time domain and in the frequency domain. But without the rest, without the local information, maybe this is also not worth to do now. Of course, we are waiting for our colleagues and friends' works at 5 PN, this harmonic coordinates-based potential Hamiltonian, which has been obtained starting from pioneering works of Foffa, Sturani, Porto, etc., and the recent work by Blumlein we have heard right now. The best contribution I'm waiting for is something which comes from the scattering angle and self-force. Self-force can compute the scattering angle, and this will give us both, again, local and non-local information. Computations were announced at the last CAPRA meeting by Barak and collaborators, but in the literature still it exists a preliminary paper, not a target to the scattering angle, but using hyperbolic motion by Setoper. We have seen the nice and very recent contribution by Zvi Bern and the collaborators concerning the potential part of the scattering angle at 4 PM, but still we need to add perhaps the contribution of the radiation gravitons, and this is under investigation, I think, at the moment. Indeed, there are new and promising avenues from scattering amplitudes, many different works of people involved in this game, Veneziano, Porto, Paramartinez, Vernizzi, etc., just a few names. And then one has to extend these results to include the spin to the bodies. I have seen some preliminary works by Alessandra Bonanno, Jan Steinhoff, Justin Vines, and maybe one can push this result much more beyond using the tutti frutti strategy, let's say. So that's it. Thanks for your kind attention, and I'm here for your questions.
Thank you very much, Donato. So we shall take questions. Thibaut, you have still your hand raised.
No, sorry,
Okay, so we shall take another question if there is one.
Hi, Donato. Can I ask you a question? Is anybody
online? I'm here.
Yeah, yeah. So we are trying to do the full so-called soft scattering angle at 4 p.m., right? Including potential and radiation. But one thing that I haven't found a way to do yet, I mean, I discussed this in my talk, is the small eccentricity expansion of the non-local term, obtain that from the hyperbolic motion through this analytic continuation, etc. So what I don't understand from your analysis is how do you learn about the small eccentricity expansion of the non-local Hamiltonian from the hyperbolic solution?
But this is, you see, you have seen different blocks. This was used in the first block. I have computed the two gauge invariant quantities by using elliptic-like motion, because I was working with the EOB DJS gauge form of the metric, and this was enough for me. So the connection is indirect in the sense that I have used the four preliminary steps. Then I have the EOB metric. I can put in another gauge. This energy gauge is much more convenient when you study hyperbolic motion, and the parameters are fixed. Then there is only a canonical transformation between the two. Then I can use the knowledge I have about these coefficients to study hyperbolic motion, the scattering angle.
Yeah,
not directly.
Yes, what confuses me there is that the Lowney average, the local Hamiltonian that you get from the non-local guy, has very different coefficients if you do the large eccentricity expansion or if you do the small eccentricity expansion. For example, the zeta of 3 is gone, right, when you go to the bound case. So clearly the coefficients of your EOB for hyperbolic and elliptic cannot be the same, right?
Of course, but I was using only the elliptic-like form exactly. of the EOB.
Exactly. So how do you have a way to understand how you map that information to elliptic?
But for me, this is easy in the sense that I know the form of EOB has an expansion on PR, the radial momentum. PR is the eccentricity. So if I go at 6 p.m., I know what are the coefficients entering the higher power of PR entering. So I know the higher power of eccentricity entering, and I can perform the computation up to that level. Only okay. this.
We can discuss that later because it doesn't converge, right? So that's my problem. Because I will need all the orders in 1 over j to actually get from the scattering the small eccentricity expansion of my Hamiltonian.
No, but follow me. Once the coefficients of the EOB Hamiltonian are fixed by using elliptic-like motion, the Hamiltonian is fully determined. Then, by using a canonical transformation, I go to another gauge, but now my Hamiltonian is known. And with this one, I compute the scattering angle, not with the first one. It's an indirect, anyway, I am at disposal. I mean,
we can discuss. We can. I thought that the local averaging will give you very different answers. And you cannot just transform one into the other. But maybe I didn't understand what you guys are doing.
There is a canonical transformation, my friend.
But how can it be a canonical transformation that will be equivalent? And
have shown, it's written.
Okay, we can discuss. Thank
okay.
You. Okay. Another question. Alessandra Buonanno.
Yeah, in fact, I had a similar question than, you know, Raphael, and I wanted just a clarification rather than just what you were saying. So at the end, you have the Hamiltonian in this energy gauge, but if I want to study the bound case, and I want actually to go back, how I can go back to, to the gauge that is more suitable for
quantitative. Yes, I understand this question, but I obtained first the DJS gauge with which you can naturally study bound motion.
But so, I want also the information that you have at 5 p.m. and 6 p.m. that you have done in this other gauge using scattering.
Once I have a canonical transformation connecting the two Hamiltonian, if I determine one coefficient in one side, I have the map for the other side. This is what we did. I know that the undetermined coefficients in the energy gauge are related to the determined coefficient in the DJS gauge, and I fix them.
Okay, maybe we should really discuss.
No, we should discuss that later. No, because we know that there are things that don't work this way, but we can talk later.
Okay, the next question by Kia Xian Shen.
Yeah, thanks for a beautiful talk. So I have a question about the non-local in time part using EOP. So you mentioned that it's not straightforward to get that up to 6 p.m., but beyond that will be more complicated. Could you comment on what's the complication to go beyond 6 p.m.?
Computational, technical computations, in the sense that if I work in the time domain, the extension in space of the integrands is very large, and it's almost impossible to determine them analytically. Then we use this high precision numerical computation, knowing the structure and fixing the results. Then we attempted, and in many cases we succeeded, in showing that this is exactly the result. But as I told you, if I work in the frequency domain, for me the main difficulty is to expand the Bessel K function with respect to the order, which is needed because the integration variable appears also in the order. This is the main difficulty I find. Then technical issues like the use of the Mellin transform has been helpful in many cases.
As you said, so the form of the integrand, the split flux, that part remains to be the same even beyond 6B, and the complication is coming from the integration. Is that correct?
Indeed, yes, as I told you.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. At some stage, Donato, you mentioned the work on the gravitational cell force calculations by Kavanagh et al. Up to the incredible order 22 pn. And you said that it is pity that this work has been only done once. But we could check the higher powers of the logarithms in the energy function using the redshift and the first law.
Yes, yes, I know. I know your paper, of course.
22 pn.
It was not a negative comment. It was a highly positive comment. This young researcher, Chris Kavanagh, did an incredible job.
Yes.
Okay. Especially because I was working on this and on my machines, there was no way. At a certain point, the number of information stored in my computer was so high that I had the continuous crashes.
Okay.
So I'm astonished. But then I've also been working with Chris, and what we did was very low PN, not so high PN. I think that once you touch for a moment, then you know what it means.
It was to say that we found that it is completely correct.
Indeed, I'm sure, yes. Yeah,
of course. So I don't see any other question, and I think it's time to stop the session, and probably the organizers want to